The sporting spotlight shines on racing this autumn, whether it's Moonee Valley or Mornington, Rose Hill or Randwick. Betfair has you covered with a range of markets. At Betfair, winners are welcome. So play your way on Betfair this autumn.
Gamble responsibly. If gambling becomes an issue, call 1-800-858-858.
Yes, a very good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Tab Touch Lounge, Saturday morning edition. Peter Vlahos, Alana McLean with you. We're here through until 11 this morning, and you can get involved with us anytime, 0487 736 736. As we prepare for Super Bowl 56. Alana, good morning to you.
Good morning, Pete. Oh, I can feel the excitement brewing.
Do you understand the rules?
Not really, but I love a good event. Do you know what I mean? I'm just one of these people that I get caught up in the hype of something. And I think even if you don't understand, it's sort of like Melbourne Cup Day, isn't it, really? Yeah. Even if you don't understand, you know, the complexities of the racing industry or whatever, you want to have a good day, you want to have a punt, you know, there's something for everyone. We've got the ads, they draw a lot of attention. Obviously, some of the world's biggest advertisers put millions into their ads, so people watch those. They go viral. We've got the entertainment, of course, so it's quite a spectacle.
Yeah, it's a big event for SEN Network as well. SEN will be broadcasting the Super Bowl. The coverage starts around about 7 o'clock Western Standard Time on Monday morning. Jared Waitley will anchor the coverage, and we'll speak to Jared Waitley in a matter of about 15 minutes as he previews Super Bowl 56. It's one of those things that's grown, hasn't it? The Americanism that has infiltrated into our community in recent times is quite amazing. And when you look at it, you know, away from sport, Halloween wasn't even thought about many years ago. All of a sudden now October the 31st becomes a significant event, and people go out and, like Christmas, decorate the front of their house with spiders and webs and all that. But there's so much Americanism that has infiltrated, I reckon, into Australian society. And
Valentine's Day is on Monday.
Yes.
So there's another one. There's your handy reminder. Your eyes have lit up. They're going, geez, I better mark that in the calendar.
Valentine's
Don't annoy
Day.
The wife. I've seen the, I went to get the paper, as I always do before we do the show, and the servo was starting to fill up with, you know, they bring in all the roses to the servo for
the last minute
pickups.
Because we go to the same servo.
We do.
Yeah, we do. I saw you actually walking out this morning. But saying that, we've got Valentine's Day, and of course the basketball from a sporting perspective, the NBA wasn't really on the radar many moons ago. Now is quite prominent in Australian sporting society, and also the fact that so many Australians now are playing in the NBA. And, you know, the Super Bowl is growing and people are getting a bit more of an education of it. I must admit, I know more about the idiosyncrasies of the Super Bowl and gridiron as we knew it, or the NFL as it's known, than maybe years ago, because we're now exposed to it more frequently.
Yeah, and I think as well, I mean, we had Tom Brady. I mean, what a legacy. Yeah. So I think even if you didn't know much about the sport, we sort of had that period of years where he was playing in all those championships. So people had different touch points, I guess, to get involved and understand a little bit more. And certainly, you know, we have spoken about it a fair amount on this show, but the entertainment is something that draws people in. And even if you don't watch the full game, people are generally tuning in for that halftime show. And we've seen that, you know, over a number of years, it keeps getting bigger and bigger.
Let me give you a snapshot on what the halftime show is going to be like. It runs for 30 minutes and it'll sound something like this.
Well, I do, so f*** him and f*** you too. You think I give a damn about it?
Yeah, Yes, this is the Tab Touch Lounge, not Triple J, you're listening to on this Saturday morning with Alana and Pete.
Pete's favourite hits. I could see you driving down the coast there with your windows rolled down, yeah, you know.
I saw you swaying from side to side as well. But that's going to be, they've got all these LA rappers and they're basically going to be the halftime entertainment.
Oh, it's going to be extraordinary.
Do you know the halftime entertainment for the Super Bowl? I just did some homework on it, Alana, is that many, many years ago when they incorporate the halftime entertainment, it was made up of marching bands.
Was
from,
it really?
From the local colleges and high schools. But the popularity of the game increased and they thought they'd better bring in some popular singers and musicians. And, of course, it was probably highlighted some years ago when Michael Jackson, the late Michael Jackson, performed at halftime of a Super Bowl.
Oh, that was iconic.
And that halftime entertainment outrated the game itself.
Yes. Well, I mean, interesting, even when we sort of preview, I guess, the halftime entertainment for this, Mary J. Blige has come forward and said that they actually don't get paid, which is, you know, I think a lot of people are thinking, my gosh, you know, the budgets that go into a sort of spectacle of this size, but they actually don't get paid. She said, however, it's the opportunity of a lifetime. So it is an extraordinary honour to be asked to be in the halftime entertainment. But I think from this perspective, Mary J. Blige has said, this is going to be the most epic thing in music in hip-hop and R&B history. LA is never going to be the same after tonight. So they're big words. So
yeah,
they're going to expect, you know, delivery on a massive scale.
About 20 years ago, U2 performed, I remember, at halftime. And their third song was Where the Streets Have No Name. It was on the backdrop of the September 11 attacks.
Oh,
so they performed that, and there was all this footage of the September 11 attacks. And what will come out of it? Because the people that we've just given you a bit of a snapshot, Mary J. Blige just making those comments, there will be some sort of undertone there, some sort of political statement of some sort that'll be resonated out to the world, because it'll be a great stage for somebody to express, as the rappers do tend to do, something that they're not happy with or they're happy with in the world these days.
Well, we saw last year we had Jennifer Lopez and Shakira, and Jennifer Lopez did make a political statement when, you know, she said, you know, we are all American.
Yeah.
And she had Bruce Springsteen's song playing, but that was a real homage, I guess, to the Latino community, the Hispanic community, you know, being integrated into sort of the broader sense of the community. So I think we will probably see a lot of messages, and obviously off the back of George Floyd and the Black Lives Matter movement, that's been massive over in the States as it has been globally. So I'm sure that there'll be plenty of messages, but plenty of entertainment too.
Oh, no, it'll be good. And let's hope the game's a beauty between the Cincinnati Bengals and the LA Rams. The Rams will start favourite. We'll talk more to Jared Waitley in just a moment. Also later on, of course, live sport returns to Perth this weekend. And a bit of controversy regarding how our AFLW teams can get in when some of the others, like the Wildcats and the Glory, just to name a couple, are still stranded, and others are trying to get in, that is individuals that haven't been able to get in. Eliza Riley's going to join us. The Eagles play tomorrow. The Dockers play today here at Optus Stadium, actually.
Yeah, huge win for the Eagles girls as well. Finally chipped up one there, so plenty of celebrations. And speaking of celebrations, the Winter Olympics, Aussies are doing so well. Like, for a summer country, we're doing extraordinarily well. We've had a bronze, a silver, and
Scott
a gold.
Scott James so close to gold yesterday. So we've got one gold, one silver, one bronze so far.
Yes, and we're going to be chatting to Michelle Steele around 10:45 this morning, because Jacqueline Narricot, she is in the women's heat in the skeleton tonight. So Michelle is going to be doing all the calling for that.
And what I'm going to ask Michelle is the dynamics of the skeleton and how it works and how you train for something like that. Look, I have seen a couple of the sports undertaken, and I think to myself, certainly the luge, where they go down head first at a million miles an hour. And I think, well, they've perfected it now because they're Olympians. But there must have been times when they were training that they would have incurred some injury of some sort. They wouldn't have got it the way they are now. It would have taken years and years and years to perfect it. But in that time, there may have been a broken bone or two.
Yeah, for sure. And I think when you're talking about such niche little, you know, sports like that, well, not little, but you know what I mean? Like, there's such a small percentage of people that would even look into doing something like that. How do they actually get started? That's what I want to know. Because, well, one day you just wake up and go, you know what? I want to go head first, like the clappers. you know, and just see what happens at the other end. It's very interesting, I think, the progression of those sports.
And I reckon there are people that love speed that do something like that, because I reckon they go home, they've got a muscle car because they love speed. You know, I can't understand.
Adrenaline junkies.
Exactly. Or they go down to Ravenswood and blow rubber and burn rubber. But anyway, it's interesting. So we're going to find out more about the skeleton a bit later on. It's 10 past nine. We'll take a quick break. Jared Waitley is going to join us live from LA after the break. This is the Tab Touch Lounge with Alana McLean and Peter Vlahos on this Saturday morning, heading for a top of 29 degrees today, nice and mild.
Before it starts
to warm up again tomorrow and into the working week. Tab Touch, you can always bet your bet with Tab Touch. Gamble responsibly. Of course, they've been going 60 years, and if you need some assistance, the number to call is 1-800-858-85. The cloud has cleared. Blue skies have made their way. A 29-degree Saturday coming your way. Tab Touch Lounge with Peter Vlahos and Alana McLean on this Saturday morning. Of course, you may be listening on SEN Track 657 or SEN Spirit on 621 through Bunbury and our glorious southwest. Great to have you on board. And on Monday morning, on the SEN network, you can hear coverage of Super Bowl 56. It's going to be one for the ages, the Rams against the Bengals. Two probably that you wouldn't have expected to be there when you looked at the NFL season at the start. And anchoring SEN's coverage is Jared Waitley, and he joins us live from LA. Jared, a very good morning.
Pete, Alana, hello. Yes, greetings from a very warm Los Angeles where it's about 31 degrees in an incredible winter stretch for this city as it looks towards its showpiece on Sunday night, American time.
Oh, wow. Well, Jared, firstly, I mean, we have to ask the big question we've all been wondering in here. How did you get on a junket like this?
It'll be my fifth Super Bowl. Called four in person, and I will have called four in person and one in the studio last year when we weren't allowed to travel. So, yes, my first experience was Minnesota, where it was minus 25 degrees. I've been through Atlanta, Miami. We couldn't go to Tampa Bay last year and now to Los Angeles. It's interesting. It's 29 years since LA has hosted a Super Bowl. And given that the town regards itself as one of the great sporting cities of the world, and I think the boast is the best sporting city in America, they've had a strange on-off relationship with NFL teams, which left them essentially ineligible to be able to host the showpiece game for the best part of three decades. So there's a huge sense of expectation. There's a bursting sense of pride in the stadium that's been built here. It's a $5.5 billion stadium. It's been built by the owner of the Rams, and now the Rams are going to play in it. So it's very accessible in the streets of Los Angeles. Is that sense of a main event, a party town, and the football prize that's on offer.
Yeah, and it's certainly that's one of the headlines. And there'll be many headlines coming out of Super Bowl 56, the Rams' first Super Bowl title in 22 years. And the Bengals, Jared, have come from nowhere, haven't they?
Yeah, they really have. As nobody would have imagined that they would be part of this. I think after week two, they were 200-1 shots coming into the playoffs. They hadn't won a playoff game in 31 years. They're at home. They beat the Raiders. There was a huge celebration. And I think really the idea that's probably as far as they would go now. They upset the number one seed in their conference when they beat the Titans. And then they went to Kansas City as monstrous underdogs. They trailed by 18 points against the best quarterback in the game, Patrick Mahomes. And they somehow staged a second half comeback, which was astounding in real time. And I think even more so, looking back on it, there are those who are commenting that they have gone back and watched the game with the same sense of disbelief they had when it was unfolding. They've done it on the back of Joe Burrow, who's their quarterback, their number one draft pick. It's his second season in the NFL. No number one draft pick as a quarterback has been quicker to a Super Bowl than this. So he has lifted a team that has been in the doldrums for decades. And while they are, again, huge underdogs, they're not being dismissed because of what we've seen in this playoff series so far. And the idea that he might be the next Tom Brady, and it's 20 years since Tom Brady won his first Super Bowl, and that too was against the Rams. So there's a few different ways to rate the Bengals as a chance, and most of them are straight through their young quarterback.
Well, another really interesting point, Jared, is coach of the Bengals is Zach Taylor going up against coach of the Rams, Sean McVay. Now, this is the youngest head coaching duel ever seen in Super Bowl history. It's quite extraordinary.
Yeah, Sean McVay's a really interesting figure. He's sort of the wunderkind of the NFL. He led the race, been the head coach of the Rams for 5 years. He took them to a Super Bowl in the second year, and they got badly beaten. They didn't score a touchdown in that game against the Patriots. They have aggressively recruited for the now, and he's regarded as the best offensive mind in the game. So he takes them again to a Super Bowl. They actually worked together at Washington when they were coming through the ranks, these two coaches. And Zach Taylor's come into the Bengals, and in his they went 2-14. They had the worst record in the NFL. Then they got the number one draft pick as a result. They won 4 games last season, and now here they are in a Super Bowl. So he has a losing record as a coach because it's all happened so quickly this season. So yes, it is the quarterbacks and the coaches are such big figures heading into the game.
Jared, if we can maybe look at you as a professional broadcaster, and you have broadcast a lot of significant events. We had the AFL Grand Final here at Optus Stadium last year. It was terrific. Melbourne against the Western Bulldogs. Firstly, a two-folded question. How did you get an understanding of the commentary required to deliver NFL football? And secondly, where does the Super Bowl rank in relation to something that we can relate to, an AFL Grand Final?
Yeah. So it is a spectacular event. And so the second question first, there's no judgment in it. It is just bigger in scale than anything else, I think, other than the 100 metres men's final at an Olympic Games. That's the only other event that I can liken it to. So it is the biggest annual event on the sporting calendar. That's true, not just for the game itself, but really for the cultural piece that's put around it, the iconic halftime show, which is such a big part of it. The 25 minutes leading up to it, the way that it takes over the city, it's a host city in the same way that the Olympics has a host city. And just the magnitude of the number of people who have Sunday as this huge holiday. So everywhere you go, there's all sorts of ways to participate in the Super Bowl, not the least of which is through chicken wings, for instance. So everywhere you go is selling chicken wings because that's the cultural piece. So, it's your Australia Day barbecue, sort of 50-fold, I think, over here. And the first part, I've always followed the sport, so I'm in my mid-40s. When I was a kid, Don Lane had a highlight show. I think it was every Tuesday night on the ABC, and those were in the days where the Giants and the 49ers after them with Joe Montana, they were the iconic teams and players of the day. So I'd always followed it. I watch a lot of it on telly. And then once the opportunity came to be able to broadcast it, I started to listen to it a lot on radio, and then the terminology and the trends and the tactics and the players are very much sort of part of what I take in across the 4 or 5 months that it's being played. And it's a huge privilege to be there at these games. These are $10,000 a ticket to be there at this new stadium on Sunday night. And I had the privilege of being there and then taking all of our SEM audience vicariously there and to savour the atmosphere of what's such a showpiece. So it's something that I feel extremely privileged to do. I absolutely love doing it. It appeals to the fan in my heart, maybe more than, or just as much as anything. So it doesn't quite resonate in the same way as whatever happens in an AFL Grand Final for us is those moments live on in our imaginations for as long as we follow the game, for as long as we have our memories. So the moments that happen in Super Bowls aren't quite the same for us culturally, but they absolutely do here, that's for sure. So, yeah, it's incredibly complex, but it's actually quite simple to describe. It's a march up and down the field, and my task is to give you a visual picture of that march up and down the field as it happens in 10-yard increments as the game unfolds. So I've got Larry Fitzgerald by my side. We've done a few together now. He's a 50-year NFL Giorno, who's one of the most respected writers in the game. He's a bit like Mike Sheehan. He'd be America's answer to Mike Sheehan. And his son, Larry Fitzgerald, has just finished a Hall of Fame career at Arizona. So I always feel in great hands that he can share the intricacies of the game with you while I describe the action as it unfolds.
Jared, what's the feeling like over there in LA at the moment? Because all the reports that I was sort of reading was that it was very crime-stricken, throughout the pandemic and in the aftermath of that. But you're sort of saying that the city really does come to life for an event like this. I mean, what are you sort of seeing over there on the ground?
Yeah, so I'm seeing a party town at the moment, I must say, as we are in the heart of Hollywood. So we're one block from the Hollywood Walk of Fame, where it starts on Hollywood Boulevard, and some of the iconic landmarks and images that you would know so well from movies and from magazines and the like. And day by day, it becomes sort of a more audacious party scene. So I'm holed up in my room a fair bit at the moment because that scene doesn't quite suit me. But yeah, and it culminates tomorrow with a sort of a carnival type event that Shaquille O'Neal is staging in Los Angeles, which is $1,800 a ticket.
Oh, wow.
So it's got a main stage where there'll be concerts right through the night and carnival rides. And yeah, so LA is using everything that it's got. It's the downtown area, which has got the old Staples Center, Crypto.com Arena, and the convention center is sort of the media hub. That's where all the television networks are set up. The ESPN has a set up at Disneyland. So the weather is just so good with the beaches and the like here. It's sort of all in play. So while the Rams are not the Dodgers or the Lakers in terms of the place in the affection of the city, the Super Bowl is. And as I mentioned before, it's 29 years since they've hosted it. There is that sense of A, pride, and B, is where the hell have you been? If you're going to stage an event like this, it belongs in Los Angeles. And here's how it's done. And last night at their honours show to name the MVP, they had Hollywood star after music star. So it's garish, I think, in a way.
And you spoke about the quarterbacks. We spoke about Tom Brady earlier, probably the legendary quarterback of all time. And they are the overwhelming favourites likely to win the Super Bowl MVP. And they're so strategic on who wins the big one Monday morning our time. You mentioned Stafford, you mentioned Burrow. And they are likely to be the keys to what promises to be, hopefully, a very entertaining Super Bowl 56.
Yes, and so you're right. It all runs through the quarterback, and it's almost a rarity when a player other than a quarterback wins the MVP. I do think there's a chance this year is Aaron Donald, who is one of the defensive players for the Rams, is that there's a compelling argument to say he's actually the best player in the NFL at the moment. And he embodies the long wait for the Rams to win the Super Bowl again. And so he's spoken about the one thing that he wants now out of his career is a ring. And it's had quite a galvanizing effect on the team. So but without getting too far into the intricacies of it, it feels like the defensive setup of the Rams will overwhelm the offensive setup of the Bengals. And if that's the case, Aaron Donald will be the player who spearheads that. I think there's so much affection for his quest that if he has that type of game, he could very well upset the norm. But Matt Stafford he's a number one draft pick from, 13 years ago now, who went to Detroit. 12 years there, never won a playoff game. The Rams brought him in thinking that he might be the solution to the last piece that they wanted. And in his first season, he takes the Rams to a Super Bowl. So if he plays to the capacity he's shown us in recent weeks, he'll be a compelling figure. He'll be hard to stop. But, yeah, I just got a sneaky feeling that Aaron Donald in a game that the defense might dominate, certainly from a Rams perspective, he'd be a sneaky chance of your MVP.
Before Alana throws you the final question about your prediction for the big one on the SEN network on Monday morning Australian time, can I ask you about the Australian connection? It all started in the 90s. Darren Bennett, a youngster from East Fremantle Football Club, who of course played in the AFL, went over there, and I think he may have actually got in the NFL team of the decade for the 1990s. We had Ben Graham, and we've had others now, and we've got a punting school here in Western Australia. All of a sudden, it's on the radar for Australians now, isn't it?
It is, it is. So I'm here with Ben Graham. He's going to be part of our team as well. So he was the first Australian to play in the Super Bowl. That was 13 years ago. He hasn't been back to the event since. So he's having a great time reconnecting with some of the players that, were part of his journey. And he had 8 years in the league here. He's the only man to have played in an AFL Grand Final and an NFL Super Bowl. And then we were speaking today with Jordan Mailata. So he's a lad out of Sydney who came across 4 years ago, and he's playing for the Philadelphia Eagles, and he's not a punter. So this is sort of the evolution of it, is that precious kicking skill which the Australians bring through their natural upbringing is Jordan is making his way as an offensive linesman. And he's just signed a four-year contract worth $64 million. And he's 24, and they believe that he's got the capacity to be an all-pro player, sort of the best of his position across the league. So it's fascinating to see that development. And we'll play that interview before the game on Monday morning, Australian time. And that just gives a little insight of an idea that started with Darren Bennett kicking the ball a long way and Ben Graham took further, has caught on in other ways now, and transferable skills. So even if you haven't grown up with the sport, if you are athletically gifted and have size about you, there's not just the role for punting. So, yeah, and the popularity of the sport has grown progressively over the past decade, I think, with the television coverage being so pervasive on Monday and Tuesday mornings in particular. So, yeah, it feels like it's the biggest league in the world. Maybe a couple of the European soccer leagues would dispute that, but where soccer players from Australia have long gone and shown their wares there, we're starting to see a little bit more of it in America.
Well, Jared, you said that you think that the Bengals might not be able to handle that defensive pressure of the Rams. Certainly the market at the moment has the LA Rams as the short price favourites, but what do you think about the Bengals? Can they do this? I mean, I know they're going in as the underdog, but is it that mentality of nothing to lose, everything to gain? Is that belief enough to potentially get them across the line? What are your final thoughts?
Yeah, it would be an amazing story if they did. They would be one of the greatest underdogs across the season in the history of professional sport, never mind just the NFL. So I'm totally up for that being the outcome, Alana. Mm. It would be an incredible thing to witness. But I do think the sense of purpose and mission and planning around this for the Rams, and to be in their home stadium. So they built this team for this game, for this moment. If they were to fumble that, it would be there would be a lot of gnashing of teeth around that. I think the Rams are ready to win. I think there's a rough chance they might get hold of the Bengals and make a mess of them. I hope that's not the case. I hope the Bengals Cinderella run doesn't come to a grisly end, but every now and then you get to a grand final where one team, you go, how the hell did they make it? And it's hard to sustain through that final game. So, yeah, I think the Rams will win. I suspect they'll win well, but I'm totally up for the opposite happening. I think it'd be an incredible story.
Good on you, Jared. Thanks for joining us. Yeah, don't walk the streets of LA on a Saturday night before your big call tomorrow, okay? Just stay bolted in your room.
Thanks watching for Mary J. Blige on YouTube and getting in the mood.
Very nice.
Good on you, Jared. Great calling. Looking forward to the call on the SEN network Monday morning right throughout Australia. All the best.
Terrific. Thanks, Pete. Thanks, Alana.
Okay. Jared Waitley, who anchors the SEN coverage of Super Bowl 56. We're going to take a break, Alana, and then we'll revisit the Super Bowl a bit later on during the Tab Touch Lounge with Tab Touch. The race starts when the bet's on. Hello, everybody involved with Tab Touch. Great to have you on board. 60 years and going strong. Gamble responsibly. has always been their message. We're going to talk about live sport returning to Optus Stadium and Mineral Resources Park this weekend through the AFLW next. Great to have your company here on the Tab Touch Lounge. Just some news regarding, we just spoke to Eliza Riley about the AFLW, sticking with Aussie rules. There's talk that the WAFL, the West Australian Football League competition, doesn't have a major sponsor for 2022 or even a secondary sponsor at the moment. If that's the case, I gather, what is the future of the local comp? So I believe they're looking for up to $1 million around that mark, because a lot of that is paid to Channel 7, who televised the WAFL. So I know that Maccas were involved last year, Optus. Seemingly, if they're not involved this year and nobody comes to the party, what happens to the Channel 7 telecast of the WAFL? Maybe that's in jeopardy, because certainly 7 don't do it out of their own bat. They require an injection of funds from sponsors through the WAFL to get the telecast up and running. So there you go.
Well, it will be interesting, you know, and it would be so sad if that doesn't get to continue. I'm sure that a sponsor will come through, you know, in this environment wherein WA is thriving economically. I'm sure that they will. But there is a lot of rigorous processes that have to be put around sponsorships these days. And I think when you're starting to mention, you know, fast food outlets and the like, and suddenly the alignment has to be spot on for a sponsorship to be really viable in this landscape.
I've been speaking to somebody that's very closely connected with the telecast. It doesn't rate that well, to be fair. Let's be quite brutally honest here. It doesn't pull a lot of eyeballs, the WAFL, on a Saturday or Sunday afternoon. The grand final pulls a few, but the week-to-week doesn't. And the way that Seven West have gone with streaming, they've been streaming secondary competitions like the private schools competition, the Southwest competition. I wouldn't be surprised to see the WAFL become a competition that is streamed through the Seven West websites. And that's the way I see it happening in the future, rather than, of course, occupy a position on Saturday afternoon where economically probably it's not viable anymore.
So, no, that's a fair point. That's a fair point. And I think, you know, that's just the way that it's going now with streaming anyway. And I mean, even when we talk about the Olympics, what they've managed to do is have such high quality broadcasts, but happening through the app on 20 different sports at a time almost. You know, when we look back at the Tokyo Olympics, that's what they had on all the stations. So it's not necessarily a bad option, but I understand that it would be sad if it, you know, loses that sort of spot.
And I just think
it's the changing landscape.
Of course, particularly the West Australian and their online component, they are trying to drive people to their online platform, their digital platform. So I just think the waffle, in time, it could be as early as this year, could end up possibly there.
You're a big waffle man, though, aren't you?
Oh, well, I grew up with a waffle. Yeah. I grew up with a waffle. You know, my teenage years were following the WAFL competition when they used to pull over 20,000 people to the game. You know, and then, of course, the AFL came in 1987 and the whole landscape changed. What I'm really happy about, Alana, is I'm a huge Kelly Slater fan. I know I was never a surfer in my time, but I admire elite sports people. And what Kelly Slater did at the Pipeline event in Hawaii a couple of weeks ago, taking it off as he nears 50 years of age, it's come out today that people have been thinking that he doesn't want to be vaxxed. Well, he's come out today saying that he has been vaccinated against COVID-19 ahead of his return to Australia this year, because he'll come and surf at Bells Beach, the iconic event over Easter in Victoria, around Torquay and that.
Yes, yep.
And then after that, it's the Margaret River Pro here at Margaret River, and he'll come for that. And it'll be a massive, massive draw card, Kelly Slater, as he approaches 50, might even be 50 by then, after what he did at Pipeline.
I met Kelly Slater at the Margaret River Pro years ago, and I think it would be going back almost 10 years, but he was there, and he was in the, I guess,
that's what he was here. I recall that.
I think he's only been here once, has he?
Well,
I think so. It was, and it was right when Steph Gilmore was starting to take off. I was at a sponsors function
as I do love a junket.
Where's the wine? But you know, he was a lovely guy. He gave everyone his time. He's very short. Like, I remember thinking that. But you know, when they're sort of, you know, you're watching it, And there's so much happening around them. I didn't realise how short he was. But in the photo, I had the heels on and I think I was a bit like, ooh, he's right down there. But lovely guy, and it would certainly be a massive draw card to have him back here in the West for sure.
So there's a lot of skepticism regarding his vaccination. He reckons he has been vaccinated, which means that opens the door for him to come to Australia. And just some cricket last night. I reckon T20's on the nose. Only 12,908 people went last night to see Australia do battle with Sri Lanka. Australia, as we know, won the five-match series by 20 runs. Well done to Ben McDermott, who top scored with 53 off 41 balls. But they're now saying, where is T20? 12,000 people in a big SCG wasn't exactly a great look.
Do you think it's just, I know that the issue is separate from what's happened with JL during the week, but yeah. Do you think people are just a bit like, we need a reset on this? You know, like, were people really into the cricket? Everyone has been cricket overloaded. There's been a lot of drama unfolding and it hasn't, you know, been positive in any way, shape or form, really.
Possibly.
People are just wanting a little bit of a time out from the whole
situation. Yeah, no, you could be right. And I haven't got an opinion either way on that. But, yeah, you could be right. You could be right with what's transpired. Maybe there may have been a bit of a protest vote last night at the SCG, people not going along. But what's going to be interesting, because today it's the IPL auction, the Indian Premier League auction. They reckon Mitch Marsh, our very own Mitch Marsh, will become, if he's not already, which he probably is, a multi-millionaire. Like with what he did in the World T20 World Cup for Australia that they won, and then what he did at the Big Bash. You watch what Mitch Marsh will be purchased for at the IPL auction in India today. They're forecasting possibly well over $1 million, and that is straight in the hip pocket.
We should ask him if we can have that meal to fund the Waffle Channel 7. And then everyone's happy, right?
Yeah, and the other one that could be a big winner, even though he was dumped by the Hyderabad side, Dave Warner.
Yeah.
I reckon Dave Warner could go for big bucks. But anyway, we'll follow that. The IPL auction, India is 2.5 hours behind us, so it will be an evening event here in Perth, Western Australia. We're going to take a break, Alana McLean, and after the break,
David Short,
yeah,
the man, the myth, the legend. Tab Touch, all the markets coming your way.
Into the second hour of the Tab Touch Lounge on this Saturday morning, wherever you may be listening on SEN Track 657 or on SEN Spirit 621. A big first hour. We went live to LA and spoke to Jared Waitley, who will anchor SEN Network's coverage of Super Bowl 56 on Monday morning. So wherever you may be, all you need to do is download the SEN app. And you can listen on the SEN WA app and you can have a full coverage there. Ben Graham will be part of the commentary team, the first Australian to play at a Super Bowl. But Gerard Whateley anchors the coverage and he gave us a nice insight in that first hour into Super Bowl.
Yes, well, I was just going to say as well, if you did miss that chat, don't forget you can catch up on that by downloading that SEN app. As Pete mentioned, go into SEN Track, into the podcast, and the Tab Touch Lounge will be there after the show, as it is every week. So a great way to catch up. Speaking of the Super Bowl, though, Pete, one of the massive, massive cultural pieces, I guess, around the Super Bowl is the ads, the advertisements. Mm. Now, this has got such a cult following over the years, and the millions of dollars that some of the world's biggest companies are spending to get a 30-second ad. I just did a little bit of research. A 30-second ad for this year's Super Bowl is costing you around $9.1 million.
Yeah, just short of what it is an ad here at SEN too.
$9, we'll take it. Yeah, so that, I mean, that's just for the spot, for one spot. That's nothing even, you know, remotely related to the production. And some of these companies have so many big celebs in their ads. So you think about the budget that you'd be paying the likes of a Scarlett Johansson. She's in an Alexa ad with her husband, Colin Jost. We've got Austin Powers, the great Mike Myers. He's returning to General Motors. Lindsay Lohan. Now, she is a little bit, well, she's a bit of a wild card, though, isn't she, Peach? Mm. Let's be honest. She was sort of a teen icon, I guess. Then she went off the rails a little bit, but she's really leaning into her comeback. This is Lindsay Lohan's comeback for Planet Fitness for the Super Bowl.
People are wondering,
what's gotten into Lindsay?
She's never been sharper.
This basketball star married himself in 1996.
Who is Dennis Rodman?
Correct.
Son of a...
She's sleeping better than ever, which the paparazzi aren't thrilled about.
I miss Lindsay!
She's even more productive, trading DUIs for DIY.
The verdict is...
gorgeous. Maybe it's not what's gotten into Lindsay. It's what Lindsay's gotten into.
Hey, William.
Planet Fitness. Get glowing and feel spectacular.
Oh, there you go. And as we welcome David Short to the program, Shorty, we're coming up with a couple of quiz questions without notice on the back end of that ad. Good morning to you. We're just getting Shorty up now, I believe. There he is. So, Shorty, good morning for the second time.
Good morning. Pete Lyons, nice to be with you guys. How are you today?
Did you hear that commercial?
I missed the commercial. All right. I tell you what I can do, though. Unusual for a Saturday, but I can give you a traffic update. There's been a truck rollover.
Oh, there has around...
Right on there north.
Yes, I heard about it this morning.
Just before South Street, and it is still... it's just taking me an hour and 50 minutes to get from... my place, where I'm just rolling up now into headquarters at Osborne Park. So, just if you can for now, I'd be seeking an alternative route if you can dodge Freeway North. It's banked up from probably just around Berrigan Drive right through to after South Street. So, absolute chaos on the freeway on a Saturday morning. It's outrageous.
There was a truck rollover when I was coming into work. I heard it on the radio at about 7:15. I gather you've been in the cloak of darkness because you didn't know anything about it because you got caught up with it. Shorty, do you want us to ring you back in 5 minutes once you get into headquarters to make it a bit more comfortable for you?
Yeah, that'd be great, Pete. And by then I'll have my feet up on the dashboard.
On the Tab Touch Lounge.
Exactly.
You've got to be comfy, Shorty.
All right, Shorty. We'll call you back in 5 minutes after that traffic update. Good on you, mate. Yeah, interesting.
Thanks, guys.
William Shatner, Star Trek, was the male voice with Lindsay Lohan.
Do you know William Shatner, who's
90 now?
Is he really?
Yeah.
Wow. I mean, but this is the thing. This is the caliber of celebs that they're getting for some of these commercials. And this would be a year in the making.
Now, you would know this. I'm just going to play a bit of it again.
People are wondering.
What is the background track to this?
She's never been sharper.
This basketball star married himself in 1996.
Who is Dennis Rodman?
Correct.
Son of a...
She's sleeping better than ever, which the paparazzi aren't thrilled about.
I miss Lindsay!
She's even more productive, trading DUIs for DIY.
The verdict is...
gorgeous. Maybe it's not what's gotten into Lindsay. It's what Lindsay's gotten into.
Hey, William.
Planet Fitness. Get glowing and feel spectacular.
There you go. Oh. So Dennis Rodman's in it, William Shatner, Lindsay Lohan. You've heard the backing track, haven't you?
Yeah, but I don't know what that is. What is it?
I'm going to throw it open. 0487 736 736. What is the backing track on that Super Bowl 56 ad that features Lindsay Lohan? And who performed it? We'll see if they can get it right, our listeners here on the Tab Touch Lounge. 0487 736 736. This is Peter Vlahos rolling the discs this morning.
Today, it's Paddy Dangerfield. Next time you're away fishing or camping, make sure you travel with Dometic. Check out the CIB 26. This 26-litre insulated cooler bag combines convenient portability with cooling, so you can easily carry chilled food and drinks wherever you go. It's perfect for trips to the beach, barbecues with friends, and days out with the family. Simply add ice to your bag and you can keep things chilled for up to 29 hours in the summer heat. Dometic Mobile Living made easy.
At Hip Pocket Workwear and Safety, we know the real side of work. You work hard, we do too. We get it that no two jobs are ever the same. Bringing over 25 years' experience, we're here to help you get on with it. We're in the community, just like you. So from hospitality to medical workers to the tradesmen helping this region thrive, we love helping you get on with getting the job done. Hip Pocket Workwear and Safety, we've got you covered.
Visit your local Hip Pocket Workwear and Safety team today. Launton and Logan Central. Don't Shoot the Messenger with Caroline Wilson and Corey Perkin. Rate local tips, books, screen food, recommendations, the week that was.
Very disturbing was the news that they'd been forcing Indigenous footballers and staff and their families arriving in Queensland to live in hubs to have this pneumococcal vaccination, which white players were not required to have.
For Red Energy, 100% Australian electricity and gas, become best friends with Caro and Corey. Subscribe and listen today wherever you get your podcasts.
All right, let's see what we got. Oh, jeez.
What is it?
Oh, it's not good.
Well, we need a breaker?
Maybe the demo saw.
Then we'll need a chipping hammer.
Nah, just a core drill.
Perhaps need a diamond tip then?
You know what, Benno?
What?
If we didn't need a diamond tip, you'd be the sharpest tool in the shed.
Thanks, man.
Whatever you need, Coates Hire has a million pieces of equipment to make it happen. Call now on 13 15 52.
Ooh, a good mark to Wilson. He plays on at full pace and kicks a beauty to Thomas. Thomas gives off to Harris. Harris closes in on 50, but wait, he's tackled by Smith. Or is it Williams? Smith, Williams, scrabbles for the ball. Kicks it to a guy in blue who kicks it to some other guy in blue. Now some tall bloke has the ball. He kicks it to an even taller bloke. Kick, handball, kick.
Don't miss the best bits. You won't miss a moment if you drink wise. Proudly brought to you by Drinkwise.
It's never been more important to buy Australian than right now. Our local producers and growers are still making Aussie products here in our clean green environment to the highest manufacturing and safety standards, all while keeping Aussies in jobs now and into the future. So when you're shopping, in-store or online, look for the logo the nation trusts, the Australian-made kangaroo. And let's turn our shopping carts green and gold and support Australia. To find Australian products online, visit australianmade.com.
There's an energy company that gives you more than just gas and electricity. At Red Energy, we give you power. Power that's backed by renewable energy projects like the Mighty Snowy Hydro Scheme. Power to support our economy by choosing a retailer that's 100% Aussie-owned and operated. And the power to get award-winning customer service every time you contact our Melbourne-based call centre. So for locally born and bred gas and electricity, call Red today on 131 806.
Oh, we got to warm this place up.
Warm up and dry out this winter with Jetfire Industrial LPG and diesel-fired heaters. They're fully automatic, reliable, portable and packed with safety features. Ideal for heating sheds, warehouses, workshops or even drying paint and plaster. Jetfire, a trusted Australian brand for over 35 years. Brought to you by the makers of Spitwater Pressure Cleaners. Visit spitwater.com.au or call 1-800-SPITWATER.
With Tab Touch, the race starts when the bet's on. Tab Touch, better your bet. Gamble responsibly. Call Gambler's Help on 1800 858 858.
Well, he's quickly gone into racing headquarters. The man from Tab Touch is now comfy on the Tab Touch lounge after being caught in that freeway mess on the Kwinana. David Short for the second time. Good morning to you.
Good morning, guys. Yes, I'm just settling in. I love these Chesterfield couches here, guys. Very, very comfortable. Feeling a lot better now.
Nothing but the best for you, Shorty. Imported from Italy for you.
Chesterfield.
Lovely.
There used to be a packet of smokes my grandfather used to smoke back in the 1960s, 70s was Chesterfield.
I wonder if that's what the chairs are named after, because maybe you sat in that type of chair when you had one.
Who knows what I sat in.
We go down some weird rabbit holes, don't we, Pete?
And we had the little green bag, which was the, you didn't hear the Lindsay Lohan Super Bowl 56 ad that will be featured on American TV. How much are they paying for it again, Alan?
$9.1 million for a 30-second spot in the Super Bowl.
And, of course, the track underneath, Shorty, was Little Green Bag by the George Baker Selection, which you, of course, know.
Yes, I do. I'm familiar with the Little Green Bag.
Can I tell you, here's a bit of a quirky little sidelight to it. That song was supposed to be called Little Green Back. In other words, referring to the American currency. It's called the Greenback. So it was written as the Little Greenback, but by the time it got to the recording studios, for some reason there was a mistake. It was called Little Green Bag. So there you go, Shorty. Yeah. There's something else for you.
Wow.
Oh, I tell you one thing, I can give you a little rundown on. It might be quite appropriate tomorrow because with Snoop Dogg on the menu, there could be a little green bag.
But, that's where my mind went too, but I was trying to keep it very clean on the Tab Touch Lounge, Shorty, but I'm picking up what you're putting down.
Yeah, I've been to one or two of his concerts over the years, and he's very familiar with that old track, it must be said. So,
yes.
Yeah, very nice work, but it should be that halftime.
I reckon at a Snoop Dogg concert, it's the same aroma wafting through as I experienced at a Pink Floyd concert in the 80s at East Fremantle Oval, let me tell you. Shorty, let's look at the Super Bowl of 56. We had Jared Waitley live from LA in the first hour, and he's getting really excited. Of course, he's anchoring SEN's coverage live of Super Bowl 56 right across Australia on the SEN network. We spoke to you yesterday. I know you're looking forward to it tomorrow morning our time. Has the market changed at all in the last 24 hours?
No, not considerably, guys. As we spoke about yesterday, heading in, LA are the favoured option. They're $1.50. Cincinnati's still a good outside play there at $2.63. The line at $4. How did Jared analyse the game? How did he see it panning out?
He basically says the Rams have been working towards this occasion. They haven't been, as we know, in a Super Bowl for 22 years. Their millionaire owner has built this stadium. It was built because he wanted, of course, the LA Rams to one day house a Super Bowl here. And that fairy tale has arrived. So you'd think they'd be very... Well, it'd be a huge surprise if they won. But he also stated that, as we've seen, it all comes down to the quarterback, Shorty. I think the quarterbacks have won 11 of the last 15 MVPs. So whichever quarterback plays better than the other could lead their side to victory.
Absolutely, yeah. It's always pretty much reflected too when we have a look at different markets on the game and MVP betting. Matthew Stafford heads in at 235 and Joe Burrow 335, so the market absolutely reflecting that. Cooper Kupp at 650, Aaron Donald at $12, Jamar Chase at $18. It's 26 and upwards from there. As I discussed yesterday, I'm not sort of overly strong either way into the game, but the Cincinnati come from my side of the draw, where obviously Buffalo were really good most of the season, and then of course we saw Kansas City beat them going back a couple of weeks ago, and I thought the winner would come from those two sides. Well, Kansas City were then beaten by Cincinnati, who came from a long way back. They just got a never say die attitude, and while the Rams go in as the warm favourites, they've got momentum up the Bengals, and they'll do me for a little interest on the game at the 263 as the outsider.
Yeah, it's going to be a huge game on so many levels. Another thing that we spoke to Jared about is obviously the fact that this could make, well, it is going to make history with the youngest head coaching duel ever seen in a Super Bowl. Zach Taylor, Cincinnati coach, going up against Sean McVay. So, you know, ego-wise, there's a lot on the line, isn't there, Shorty?
Oh, big time. And, Lane, what it also shows is that the way of professional sport now, you know, so often, and AFL is probably what we refer back to so often here locally, and when there's a new coaching position up for grabs, more often than not, they go back to guys that have done it 10, 15, 20 years ago. They're proven coaches. I think what we're seeing here with two young up-and-coming coaches in the NFL both getting through to a Super Bowl final, it shows that the rest of the sporting world, that you don't always have to go back to someone that's done it years and years ago. You can sometimes benefit from having two, you know, a younger set of eyeballs on your game style and your game plan, and they come in with a blank canvas a lot of the times when they're young coaches, and often they can get the best out of a team, and this is certainly two really good examples of it.
By the way, it was remiss of me not to mention that Sam and Josh text in on 0487 736 736 and got the music bed from that Lindsay Lohan commercial, which was Little Green Bag. Shorty, let's go to cricket. Interesting, only 12,908 turned up to see Australia win by 20 runs over Sri Lanka last night at the SCG, the first of five T20 matches between those two countries. And people are now saying, has T20 run out of gas?
No, Pete, I'm pretty sure I discussed this with you in the last fortnight. What is the COVID world sort of been for a couple of years? And I think a lot of people are now very comfortable watching sport from home. They're paying, you know, a minimum price for their drinks out of the fridge. They can often sort of access all of the live sporting action on their big screen at home. They can invite their mates around. They don't have to worry about Ubers to and from the game or getting public transport to and from the game. I don't think this will be isolated to T20 cricket. I think you'll find it'll take Australian sports goers a pretty significant period of time to get us back to the sort of numbers we were seeing at sporting events prior to COVID. There's the worry that some people don't want to be in the public space and catch COVID to start with, but all those other factors that I've just alluded to, we're creatures of habit. And I think most people habitually now are very comfortable consuming their sport from the lounge chair at home.
Do you think that's all it is, Shorty? Because we were discussing in here, are people a little bit put off in terms of cricket by the fallout of the JL and everything that's transpired with Cricket Australia over the last couple of weeks? Are people just a little bit off cricket in terms of that loyal fan base at the moment? Maybe do people just need a little bit of a reset?
I think that there's a lot of people that are off Cricket Australia, the way they've handled the Justin Langer situation, no doubt about that, and that's understandable.
But is it flowing through, do you think? No?
Maybe. No, look, like I said, I think it's a combination of a few things. People just are now in the habit of not necessarily going to games. I must also say that there hasn't been a lot of build-up focus on this series between Australia and Sri Lanka. To be fair, Sri Lanka are one of the lesser lights in world cricket at the moment. They lost, you know, a stack of their high-quality senior players a few years ago, and they haven't really had much of an impact since they lost those guns. So, to be honest with you, I don't think it's billed as a blockbuster series. I guess we'll really find out more later in the year when the T20 World Cup's in Australia, because traditionally, when we have a big sporting event and a big cricket event like that in our backyard, we get right behind it. And generally, you know, ticket sales will be massive for an event like that. So that'll be the test for everybody. And I think Cricket Australia will be pretty nervous on those numbers and what they saw there last night. And there's a fair bit of water to go under the bridge between now and then. But if you did a public survey of cricket fans around Australia right now, what they thought of the job that Cricket Australia is doing, I don't think there'd be too many that would be ticking the extremely satisfied box.
Okay, Shorty, before we move on to the NBL, the NBA, and have a look at the EPL and also A-League, ahead of what's going to be a big day of racing, I know you're very close to the Marsh family. Mitch Marsh, IPL auction today, after what he did at the T20 World Cup, after what he did at the Big Bash. Moolay, Moolay, Moolay. I reckon he's in for $1 million plus, I reckon, at the IPL auction today.
I would suggest that there's going to be some very large numbers thrown his way, to be honest with you guys. And I'm delighted for him. I'll be honest with you. Over the years, he's actually turned down some very big money deals in the IPL to concentrate on getting a spot in the Australian side. So at some point, he has to absolutely cash in on his value. In my mind right now, he's the most destructive white ball batsman in world cricket. So he's entitled to go for a really, really large sum of money, and I'm pretty sure he will do.
Yeah, he certainly will. All right, let's go to the NBL. The Wildcats do battle with Melbourne United. A special match for Jesse Wagstaff. Becomes only the second Wildcat to notch 400 games. What a celebration for him. And let's hope the Wildcats can celebrate in the right way against Melbourne United. Take us through the market for that match and what's happening in the NBL this weekend.
Yeah, they're a good price tonight, the Wildcats, at $2.10. We touched on yesterday. They did the job against Southeast Melbourne last week in stunning fashion. $2.10, the Wildcats, $1.74, Melbourne United. Line, it's at 2 points. The early game there today, the tip-off at 2.30, Illawarra, $1.48, Cairns at $2.65. Line betting there at 5 points. But I'm comfortable to be with the Wildcats. They've made me some really good money again already this season. And despite them being on the road, I think they're a really good price and can serve it right up to Melbourne United, one of the other key premiership hopes in the NBL.
Well, NBA, this has been a massive week with all the trade moves. And Ben Simmons on the move.
Such good news, Alana. Look, people out there in the sporting marketplace that are very angry with Ben Simmons, and I can understand that, but I can also understand how he would have felt at the end of last season's playoffs when he was really just thrown out. He was the scapegoat for their failure in last year's playoffs, and to his own admission, he probably wasn't right up to scratch. But the year before, Embiid hadn't exactly dominated, and Simmons didn't go out and throw him under the bus. There was not a lot of love or support there for him. It's been a tough time for him. I said to Pete yesterday, Lana, if he was going to land at one franchise and you could have had a wish, it would have been that he landed with Patty Mills, because he right now is one of the most wonderful leaders in Australian sport, in that international environment across there. We saw it in the Olympics. And he'll take Ben under his wing. He'll make him feel really welcome in that environment there at Brooklyn. And I'd just love to see him come back with some confidence and with a team that really want him to be a part of it and get around him. And I'd love to see him have some success. Everybody has their ups and downs in life. And I think he's got a decent heart, this guy. He's copped a pretty rough deal on the way through. I'd like to see him get the opportunity to redeem himself. And I think he can quite potentially do that at a really good playing list with Brooklyn and with Patty Mills around him. We've got some games tomorrow to look forward to in the NBA. Memphis taking on Charlotte, 285 the Hornets, the Grizzlies 145. OKC, big outsiders for their clash with the Chicago Bulls, 675 the Thunder, Bulls $1.12. That line's fat at 12.5. LA Clippers take on Dallas, 305 the Clippers with the Mavs at 140. And the final game sees the Phoenix Suns 104, $11.50 in a two-horse race for Orlando Magic. That line's big as well at 15.5 points. So some good games to look forward to tomorrow morning.
And before we take a break and come back with all the news regarding racing at Caulfield Randwick and very much here at our home base at Ascot, let's have a look at the EPL and also the A-League. Of course, the Perth Glory, who are still in the Eastern States, take on the Central Coast Mariners tomorrow. 2:45 our time is that match. But first, Shorty, because Sam, our producer, is a big Liverpool supporter, no doubt keen to see how the Reds go this weekend. What are the markets for some of the select games in the EPL and also the Glory's chances against Central Coast tomorrow?
Well, Sam, he's not going to get rich backing his boys this weekend, because they're $1.28 Liverpool. The draw at $6, Burnley at $10.50. The early game tonight sees Man U up against Southampton, 157 for the Red Devils. A draw, 440, Southampton at $5.60. Brentford take on Crystal Palace, the Bees at $2.65, the draw $3, and Crystal Palace at $3.05 there. Deeper into the weekend, Man United, no, that's midweek. Leicester City, West Ham's probably the other game we'll have a look at there. $3.05 for Leicester, the draw $3.55, and the Hammers at $2.32. Tottenham, the $1.66 hot pots for their clash with Wolverhampton at $5.60. But some interesting games in the EPL this weekend.
Yeah, and just quickly, the Glory against Central Coast tomorrow, Shorty, in the A-League, 2:45 kickoff our time.
The Glory go in as the $3.30 outsiders, the draw at $3.50, and Central Coast expected to grab all 3 points there at $2.10. Pete?
Good stuff. We'll take a break. Alana and Shorty will go through all the action in racing today. It's a big one too. And you're right with us here on the Tab Touch Lounge. On SEN Track 657, SEN Spirit 621 through Bunbury in the southwest, you're on the Tab Touch Lounge at 27 to 11. You're on, Alana.
Oh. I thought you were going to bring Shorty back in. You've just gone, no.
Well,
I'm kicking back on the lounge you can take it from here.
I'm flicking my index finger and all she's doing, Shorty's looking at a bloody phone. Anyway.
No, well, I was, in fairness, I was looking at the message from Shorty. But nonetheless, look, Shorty, I could feel a little bit of change in the weather. Autumn is upon us, and that means some exciting racing and a huge day today out at Caulfield. Group one with an outstanding card, I might add.
Big style. It's time to start getting excited about the races again. That is for sure and certain. Group one racing back on the menu. Some of the stars of Australian thoroughbred racing on show today. Let's go to the group one feature there at Caulfield for today. The market here, Cinewan at the head of it at 440, open at 420, got out to 480, back into 440. It's been fairly popular as favourite. I'm Thunderstruck on the second line, 6 into 550 for the Yakka Dakka fans. Behemoth, 6 into 550. Tefane, 6 to 8. Lighthouse, a former US galloper, really, really handsome girl, or good looking girl, it must be said. She's come across and been most impressive in her career to this point across here in Australia. Over this trip, 4 starts, 3 wins and a second. She looks set to do some really good things in Oz after being a nice type over there in the Northern Hemisphere. Sierra Suze at 11, Lightsaber 12 into 11. And we also see Inspirational Girl, formerly raced here in WA, 16 out to $21. But Cinewan at the head of that market looks pretty tough to stack. Some other good races on the day, the Group 2 Rubiton Stakes, pretty open. Artorias at $3.80, Oxley Road $4, Marine One at $4.20. And, of course, we also get to see the Group 2 Blue Diamond Prelude. Miss Rosiano at the head of the market looks the one to beat, $3.60. Heard an interview yesterday with trainer Pete Galagotis, and he's really happy with where his girl is heading into the Blue Diamond Prelude there later on today.
And we just had the Autumn Stakes as well. Craig Williams taking out that one.
Absolutely, yeah. It was a really nice ride. Just managed to sneak home over Burning Power, who was coming at it late, and lucky decision, finished back in third position. But more success for Chris Waller, something we've become accustomed to in recent years.
So sure have. We're already up to race 3 at Randwick. We're flying. But race 8, the Apollo Stakes. Now, what's happening with the track over there? Because I know that you said that this was going to be a really big determining factor, was going to be the rating today. What is it sitting out at the moment?
Big time. Well, Lan, they've had a stack of rain across there in Sydney, but all the preview shows this morning have said it's almost like they put a blanket over the top of the track at Randwick, and it received next to no rain.
Right.
So the track's now a soft 5 with the prospects of a potential upgrade to even a good 4 at some point throughout the course of the meeting, which is not ideal for the horse that I had isolated when it looked like it was going to be raining there, by the name of Colette, still around that $6 mark. And she can still run well, but I'm going to just keep the powder dry there and save it for another day deeper into the preparation when we know that the track is rain affected and likely to get worse through the day. She's a girl that absolutely pops on the flippers and snorkel and does her best when the conditions are out there for the swimmers. So we'll wait for another day with Colette there today. But Think It Over is a favourite in that race, $4 over the Melbourne Cup winner from last year. Very elegant, $4.60 chance. Really good day of racing at Randwick. Couple of real highlights. Espiona goes around in the Light Finger Stakes at Group 2 level. Last time we saw this girl was on Melbourne Cup week, and she blew them up, winning by 6.5 lengths. She seemingly looked to have a fair bit in reserve as well on that particular occasion. So I would suggest that Espiona, she's one of the spruik horses of the day today. Couple of nice bets. Race 6, number 1, Lost and Running, looks really well placed today, resuming from a break. Winner of $2.2 million in prize money, 7 of 12 in to this point in time, and looks well placed to bring up another victory. Race 6, number 1, Lost and Running. And deeper into the program, race number 9, Snap Dance, is another to be ridden by James McDonald from the Mar Eustace establishment that are going really well. I would expect it to race nicely as well there in race number 9.
And it looks like it's going to be outstanding conditions today out at Ascot. The temperature looks perfection, Shorty, which is what we want to see after a few hot weeks out there. So we've got Cyril Flower Stakes, that is race 8, and Triple Missile still shaping up to be the favourite, and Brad Parnham in the saddle.
Yeah, big time. Triple Missile to this point in time has been super impressive. It's had the 8 career starts, 5 wins, 2 placings. First up's the key, goes really well fresh. It's had 3 first up runs in his lifetime. He's won all 3 of them. Punters, as soon as we put the market up here, $4.20, we're happy to be involved. It's now into $2.70. Amacinus at $5.50. Hot Z is a $6.50 chance. And the other of the listed races earlier in the afternoon, the horse that they knocked back $1 million for last week, Tricks of the Trade. Mm. It's staying local, and they're going to enjoy the two owners are both in their 80s, and they've suggested that it's all about enjoying the ride that they'll be having with this galloper, Tricks of the Trade, trained by an absolute gentleman of our industry and Mr. Colin Webster. And I'm really looking forward to seeing Tricks of the Trade zooming around there again today. Third run for the prep. Won 5 of its 6 career starts. The only time it was beaten, it was runner-up, and there were excuses. I think Tricks of the Trade will take all the beating. But you don't need to be clever to work that out. It's a $1.40 chance, and they don't normally knock back $1 million about horses that they expect to just front up and win day in, day out. So it'll be a standout there at Ascot for today, guys.
Shorty, have you seen today's West? Because Jay Rooney has done a beautiful piece on Pat and Bill Robinson, and they're looking smiley. They are absolutely beautiful. You can feel the warmth bursting off the page. These two people, you know, 90-year-old Bill is. So, you know, just outstanding. Wow. That he's just looks so healthy and loving life, and he's going to be glued to the screen today, no doubt.
Big style. And they've got a proper horse on their hands. Make no mistake about that. They'll have an absolute ball following the career of this galloper right the way through. So wish them all the very best. There'll be plenty of punters that'll be cheering hard for their galloper as well today at the short price there. But they're great stories in racing. They can take a lot. It's a great example of it. They can take a lifetime to come your way. But if you stay in the game, you're always in the mix. And they've got the horse they've been dreaming of later in life.
Before we recap your multi, Shorty, and we farewell you on this Saturday morning, let's have a look at Cannington Greyhounds tonight. Who should we be looking at?
Yeah, had a good night too down there at Mandurah last night. Three picks, two winners and a second. We just got nutted for the clean sweep. But we'll see if we can do something similar tonight there at Cannington. Going to go with race two, number seven, Papa Mono. Excellent third last week in the listed Sandy's Mum Memorial Final. Back in grade, looks really well placed. Race seven, number seven, Cassis Belli in the staying race. It'll be getting back and charging home to the line. And race 10, number eight, Sarong. It went round in that Sandy's Mum Memorial Final last week and was an excellent effort when beaten a narrow margin behind Mambo Minnelli. They're the three for me tonight. Race two, number seven, Papa Mono. Race seven, number seven, Cassis Belli. And race 10, number eight, Sarong.
Good stuff, Shorty. And just looking back at your multis, we got the first leg of your sports multi last night with Australia winning the cricket against Sri Lanka. Just recap what you've got for our listeners this weekend.
Certainly. So that leaves us with just two legs left to go. We're going with AFLW, the Frio girls, to win by 16 points or more up against Carlton. That game gets underway around 3 o'clock this afternoon. And we're going to stick fat with the Wildcats to win. If you missed last night and you want to just play now, that's at $2.94. And our racing multi, it's trimmed up a little bit from where we were yesterday, but nonetheless, again, you can chime in if you like now. We've got Melbourne Race 9, number 1, Probabile. Perth Race 5, number 1, Tricks of the Trade. And Sydney Race 7, number 8, Espiona. Just under $4, $3.92, that multi for today. Good luck to everyone playing there.
Good on you, Shorty. Enjoy your day. And we'll talk to you again next Friday here on the Tab Touch Lounge. Thanks for your time this morning.
Look forward to it, guys. Enjoy the rest of your weekend.
And enjoy the Super Bowl, Shorty. Oh, my goodness.
He certainly will. We're going to take a break. We're off to Beijing next here on the Tab Touch Lounge. Yes, great to have your company. It is the Tab Touch Lounge with Peter Vlahos and Alana McLean. And tonight, Jackie Narricot is on the verge of creating her own piece of Australian Olympic history, Alana. And
yes,
we're looking forward to this.
Absolutely, in the skeleton. And one of Australia's best skeleton athletes, Michelle Steele. She was the first woman to represent Australia in the Olympic skeleton event at the Torino Games, which was back in 2006, Pete. She's part of the Channel 7 Winter Olympic coverage and she joins us live now. Good morning, Michelle.
Hi, lovely to be with you both.
Thanks for joining us. What an exciting Winter Olympics it's been, especially for the Aussies.
And I did see a social media post as well, Michelle. You're as excited, I reckon, as Jackie.
I think I am. I think, you know, it's just such a great form she's come into this Olympic Winter Games in, and it's been so exciting watching her lead up with that win in the World Cup in St. Moritz, just coming into this event, and then putting down those first two runs last night, positioning herself at the top of the field is just so, so exciting.
Well, we were saying it's just been brilliant for the Aussies. We obviously had Tess Cody. She took out a bronze. We had Scotty James yesterday getting silver in the halfpipe. And, of course, we had Jakara Anthony taking out gold in the women's freestyle moguls. Jackie Narricot, could this be another fairy tale story?
Let's hope so. I think she's put herself in the very best position that she can. She's sounding very comfortable, relaxed. So in my mind, she has every opportunity to finish this off and bring home the gold, at least a podium, but we'll have to wait and see tonight.
They reckon the field's pretty tight, so it can go either way. It is a very, very narrow field as far as the possibilities are concerned, and as we know, Jackie is part of that. Can I talk about the equipment? Because there was a story coming out of Beijing suggesting that Team Great Britain have blamed their equipment for not being in contention this year after, of course, I think taking three medals 4 years ago in South Korea. Take us through the dynamics of the equipment that's used in the skeleton.
Yeah, so Team GB really pride themselves on their equipment. They haven't had a good Olympic campaign this year. They've just not got the fit for the track, and it's really showing in their results. So the equipment, basically, it's quite minimal in skeleton. You have a full speed suit, brush spikes for sprinting for that fast explosive push off the ice, a helmet and gloves, and that's what fits out the athlete. And then in terms of the equipment for on the ice, there is a sled, as you can see when the athletes are sliding down. So it has a saddle for the athlete to be positioned in. It comes up around their ribs, holds them onto the sled. Their arms are tucked in and they hang onto the back of that saddle with their fingertips. And then there's a pod, which is that nice shiny bottom that you see when the athletes are starting on the line. And attached to that are other runners, and they are the steels that are in contact with the ice. So there's a lot of technology, a lot of resources, a lot of big teams spend a lot of time putting as much focus as they can on getting every hundredth of a second out of their technology. So, you know, it's a big part of the sport. It's not all of the sport. There's obviously all of the sliding and the pushing and the physical capabilities to go with it. But, yeah, Team GB has done a really great job in the past, but they've just not matched the gear to the ice for this Olympic Winter Games.
Michelle, it's absolutely fascinating when we're talking about something like skeleton. I think another sport that we were talking about is the curling. They're such niche sports, but you're one of Australia's best skeleton athletes. How did you actually get into that? Because we were talking a little bit about that, you know, on the show, and that's why we're so fascinated, I think, with the Winter Olympics, is that it's so far from, I guess, the Aussie sort of norm of those summer sports. How did you get into skeleton?
I got into skeleton in 2004, so I was part of the Australian Institute of Sports Talent Identification Program that they ran in 2004, and what they did down at the Australian Institute of Sport was target skeleton as a sport that they wanted to get a woman to the Winter Olympics in. And so I tried out, it was a 30-metre sprint trial, because you need that fast, explosive push at the top. So they started off with that. They got together a group of athletes that were fast and explosive based on their time trials. We all went down to the AIS in Canberra. We did some other testing, and then they took us over to Canada to the track in Calgary to learn how to actually slide on the ice. And we had a huge support staff, an American coach with a lot of knowledge. It was headed up by Jason Goulburn, Dave Martin, some of the really big names in Australian sport talent identification at the time. So very, very fortunate, and I just progressed through the rankings within the Australian team. It was very competitive, and we put together some world-class performances over, you know, a long period of time through from there. So Jackie really is a part of that legacy.
Yeah, and just finally, as we let you go, thanks, Michelle. She's been training in the UK. Can she become the first Australian to win a gold medal in skeleton or any of those sliding sports tonight?
She absolutely can. She has all the components there. She's put them together in the first two runs. She's sitting in first position now. She's relaxed. She's happy. She's comfortable. And I really think she's going to make history tonight.
Oh,
and I reckon one of the highlights of the coverage will be, Michelle, if she wins gold, you'll be off the planet. Don't worry about that.
I will not be in my seat. Don't worry about that.
Oh, I don't think any of us will be, Michelle. All the best for the call. We're so excited for this, and hopefully Australia can bring home another gold. Thanks for your time.
Thank you. Thanks so much.
Michelle Seal joining us, an Australian skeleton racer of the past, of course, competed back in 2004. So we'll be watching that. And
yes,
it'll be certainly exciting part of the Winter Olympics.
The Olympic Winter Games are live and free on 7 and 7 Plus. You can download the 7 Plus app for your smart TV, mobile or tablet now. Definitely do that, Pete, if you haven't done that already.
That's it basically for our show today. It's been a busy one. It's been an enjoyable one. Thanks to Sam Elliott, our producer, for helping us put it together. And, of course, you won't be here next Saturday.
Yes.
You've got a commitment down south in the deep south.
I will be in Esperance. I'm flying there for the day. It is Ladies' Day out at the course. So if you are heading down to Esperance, that's where we'll be. A fantastic day of fashions on the field and all the excitement on the track. So you'll have to keep my Tab Touch Lounge seat comfy.
I will.
For me, you know, the next week, keep it warm.
And happy Valentine's Day on Monday as well.
Yes, happy Valentine's Day. Don't say we haven't helped you and done you a solid. We've warned everyone out there.
Valentine's Day, Super Bowl, of course, 56 live on the SEN
Network.
Oh,
that's a romantic way to spend it, isn't it? Hey, babe.
Have a great day.
Super Bowl.
We'll catch you next Friday on the Tab Touch Lounge.
When my mates bring their plus ones, who bring their plus ones? We're going to need more McNugs delivered.
McDelivery.
delivery.
Get dinner delivered with the 40 Chicken McNugget Pack and new spicy sticky barbecue sauce from Macca's. With delivery available at select locations.